I'm Michael Jordon, speaking to you from the U.S. state of New Jersey, where I'm quarantining from the COVID-19 pandemic. Hong Kong is one of the world's great cities and financial capitals, yet it's once again burst into global headlines due to violent clashes between anti-government protesters and Hong Kong police. But this is a far cry from the Hong Kong that I grew to love as a journalist and visiting professor. In fact, as an American who's been fortunate enough to have also lived in Europe, Africa, and Asia, of all the cities where I've worked, Hong Kong stands out as the place most like my home base of New York City. To me, Hong Kong feels like the New York of the East, as the city that never sleeps, where the dynamism of the streets fuels my adrenaline every day. I'd walk for hours, photographing ordinary people living their lives, then sit in a cafe to write about my experiences, like these photos and stories. However, it wasn't just the city I fell in love with, but with my Chinese students as well. From 2009 to 2016, I was a 7-time visiting scholar at Hong Kong Baptist University, spending 6 weeks each year teaching international journalism to about 100 graduate students. Most of my journalism students were from mainland China and generally arrived with great enthusiasm and appreciation for this opportunity to be studying in English in a territory that was what I called China Plus, certainly Chinese, but with so many features of an international multicultural city. It's because of all these memories that I'm saddened to see Hong Kong erupt in renewed violence. The central government in Beijing is now pushing for what it says is a necessary new national security law. But some Hong Kongers see it as another attempt by Beijing to impose its will on the former British colony. Since being returned to China in 1997, Hong Kong has enjoyed a degree of autonomy found nowhere else on the mainland through a policy known as One Country, Two Systems. We in the international audience hear dueling narratives between the Chinese and the West, with each side focusing on opposite extremes. The Chinese media tend to focus on the most violent protesters and their destructive actions, while largely ignoring the more reasonable protesters. On the other hand, the Western media tend to spotlight the peaceful protesters and their demands, while largely ignoring the more violent elements within their movement. Look, I myself haven't been in Hong Kong for 4 years, so I don't know exactly what the situation is like on the ground. Even many there probably don't know. But I can say with some confidence that the situation is far from black and white, with many shades of gray, and the outside world isn't receiving a full, complete picture of this reality. All that said, there can be no tolerance of violence. I recall watching one television interview last year when a Western journalist pressed a young Chinese spokeswoman for the protesters about the extremists within her movement. She refused to denounce the violence, basically asking, well, what can we even do to control those who are more violent? The fact she even refused to demonstrated a cluelessness or naivete or indicated that some movement leaders do indeed condone violence. Violence like this is not only morally unjustified, it's rarely defensible. Like other people, I myself have been furious before, even at my own government. Protest is one thing, but I never felt so outraged that it drove me to smash a shop window or destroy a traffic light or hurl a glass bottle at a police officer. Or could it be that some violent protesters hope to achieve something darker, to provoke a crackdown? They know the police must respond somehow and in a heavier-handed fashion than you. Are you hoping to have your victimization filmed, then go viral, to turn yourself into a martyr for the cause? Regardless, I'll now speak as a communications consultant. Turning to violence is also a lousy communication strategy. The protest movement clearly hopes to drum up support from Western governments, Western activists, Western media, and other backers. But if you turn violent, you also run the risk of losing the support of fair-minded, freedom of expression advocates like me. All I hope is that peace returns to this special city.